Okay, I'm here with John Fleming, who's looking pretty tired. Says penultimate night of the festival for yourself. Are you finished after tonight?
No, this is me. I'm finished tonight.
Friday. That's you. You've done the Malcolm Hardy week.
Yeah, it's Saturday I sleep.
Okay, all day, yeah.
Yeah, so I did a week. I did two debates, two spaghetti jobbing days, and then a 2-hour show.
And you've organised all these events in honour of Malcolm Hardy, yeah?
Yeah, because Malcolm, I knew Malcolm for about 20 or 30 years or something.
All right.
I met him in 1985. Wrote his autobiography for him because he said, fuck it, you have to do that, I can't do that. He couldn't remember anything.
But he couldn't even remember the stories to tell you, no? He had to go around other people.
No, he could remember everything. The problem was he couldn't remember which order anything happened in. So it wasn't that he didn't remember which year it happened in.
Okay.
He couldn't remember which decade it happened in.
Okay.
So you had to get all the stories out of him and then figure out the order in which to put them.
And that was by asking other people, basically?
No,
just logically putting it together, okay. Because you like to drink Malcolm, yeah?
Yeah.
Did one kind of year blend into the next one? Did one year kind of blend into the next one?
Especially as he started in the 60s, 70s, so drugs and...
Rock and roll.
Yeah, rock and roll,
A bit like yourself, yeah?
No,
just with that shirt on, it looks...
Cleveland Bowden.
All right.
The middle class there, shop Bowden, that's me.
So what did you find so attractive about Malcolm Hardy? Just as a friend, or did you, as comedy act itself? Could you tell us about that?
He didn't care. Someone said, it was at the Times, someone said in an obituary that he was a man who had no idea of consequences, so
all
he
right.
did whatever came into his mind.
Yeah.
And he was a sort of he was an intelligent... decent chap who decided to become a roguish character.
Uh-huh.
And apparently he, when he was about 16, he used to practice the slant of the cigarette and the mumble in front of a mirror.
All right.
And he eventually grew into the person he wanted to be.
Okay, that's very good, I like that.
Yeah.
That's what life is about, it's being Bill Hicks and creating, being the imagination of yourself.
Yeah.
So you kind of invented this Malcolm Hardy character and lived the life. Yeah. Fantastic.
He was actually a shy man who, everyone thought he was an outrageous... over the top person, which he was, because he didn't really give a shit.
Uh-huh.
But it was because he was a shy person.
Yeah, he developed that extrovert.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So when he got married, he had help on the bottom of his shoes when he knelt down.
Brilliant. That's classic. So that's why so many comedians love him, yeah? There was like 800 people at his funeral.
Well, he was a very good talent spotter. He could spot talent at 80 yards in a mist.
Uh-huh.
He spotted a lot of very talented people early on in their careers, and he helped them. That was the thing.
He had a big heart.
When no one else would book them, he would book them. And so he helped them in their careers, and he gave them advice. So then, uh-huh. Of course, lots of them then became major stars and wouldn't return his phone calls.
All right.
Oh, I'm famous, I'm wearing Armani suits, so uh-huh. Why should I have anything to do with this shambolic man who makes me look cheap and reminds me of mine?
Who he really is.
So he got shat on a lot, but he just shrugged his shoulders and said, well, it's not part of the deal. He liked to encourage talent because no one had ever really encouraged him.
Yeah, it's very nice. You obviously had a warm heart.
Yeah,
and that's heart. I think you do yourself, John, for keeping his spirit alive at the festival.
A very warm heart, me.
Yeah.
And a very big stomach as well, a very warm stomach.
That's cool. Thanks very much for talking to me. Have a good night. Bye bye.
And the world's worst interview.
No, man. Excellent.